Greetings and welcome back to NYSORA YouTube channel. In this video, we're going to further dissect the papers published by Dr. Neuman and colleagues on spinal versus general anesthesia in patients having hip fracture surgery. Unfortunately, these papers, which were published in the New England Journal of Medicine and the Annals of Internal Medicine, are really crafted in their recommendations too definitively and are misleading and have the potential to instill a negative perception of spinal anesthesia in surgeons, internal medicine specialists, patients, and their family alike. Also, it's very unfortunate that Dr. Neuman's studies have been overly simplified and covered by press and disseminated to the general public and our colleagues involved in patient care who may not have a good understanding of the benefits of spinal anesthesia in elderly and frail patients. Previous studies, including those by the same author, Dr. Neuman, on much larger data sets, have clearly documented that spinal anesthesia saves lives. The benefits of spinal anesthesia in very ill patients are obvious to anyone who practices clinical anesthesiology. The spinal anesthesia requires less invasive monitoring and less hemodynamic interventions. And while this may not be reflected in an outcome in a composite death or ability to walk at 60 days, spinal anesthesia results in a much more stable postoperative course and lower burden of care. And since this video is not a CME activity, I don't have to disclose the conflicts of interest, but I will. I'm very passionate about regional anesthesia and its benefits to patients. I don't practice regional anesthesia because it is fun. I do it because it facilitates patients' care and saves lives to many patients who are very ill, frail, or have medical conditions that make general anesthesia dangerous or unsafe. And this is why we produced this particular video. And indeed, our video on the first study in the New England Journal of Medicine on spinal versus general anesthesia in hip fracture was seen by over 42,000 people. And many have sent personal comments and comments on the video, and I strongly encourage you to watch that one. So that particular study was on spinal anesthesia or general anesthesia for hip fracture surgery, and the basic findings, the main findings, were that spinal anesthesia was not superior to general anesthesia with regards to the survival or ambulation at 60 days. Now, I question whether these primary outcome variables are relevant to clinical practice at all. And if you think about it, hip surgery or hip fracture is not a cancer, and spinal anesthesia or general anesthesia are not chemotherapeutic agents, so we're not really supposed to study life or death. Nobody would expect that administration of one versus the other anesthetic in patients who are relatively healthy, such was the case in Dr. Neuman's study, would result in a death or a life. And more importantly, the conclusions of this study are flawed. And this is why. If you look at the patient population that was enrolled in this particular study, you will see they are much healthier than what you typically see in a clinical practice. Many of these patients were excluded a priori because people did not feel comfortable enrolling them into the studies if they were sick. Moreover, these patients were able to walk before surgery and they were younger than a typical patient with hip fracture. And again, the expected outcome, composite death at 60 days, it's crazy. You don't really study an anesthetic technique or intervention based on what the outcome would be measured in death. As an example, if you dropped any of the anesthetic medications that we use in a daily practice and studied it against something else or no medications, you will never find that there will be a difference in death rates. And while the study in this paper was calculated based on a composite death or expected composite death of 34%. In this study, the composite death was only 18%, which clearly indicates that this was much healthier population than expected. The 15% of spinal anesthesia failure is also problematic. I've never seen something like this. In these 15% of cases, if you read the paper, you will see some of these spinal anesthetics could not be technically administered. Others have failed. Others have been reassigned to general anesthesia because clinicians didn't feel that they were able to perform them. So it clearly this study with the spinal anesthesia was performed by non-spinal anesthesia experts. These were not regional anesthesia experts who know how to administer spinal anesthesia for hip fracture according to a certain protocol. So the inclusion bias really does not spell reality. But let's take a look at the table 4 from the paper, which are the exploratory outcomes. The exploratory outcomes by the study design were not supposed to be analyzed. But here, as you could see, the spinal anesthesia decreased the death rate 3 times. The spinal anesthesia also decreased the chance of pneumonia 2 times. It also decreased the incidence of acute kidney injury. And if you look into the critical care admissions, it's quite clear the spinal anesthesia was way better than the general anesthesia, but these numbers were not actually analyzed, and at the end of the day, it was a too small of a sample size in a healthy population, so they did not turn out to be statistically significant. In the paper by Neuman and colleagues in their previous publication, where they had 18,000 patients and all comers, the spinal anesthesia decreased the death and the pulmonary complications by 30%. So it's quite clear that spinal anesthesia, if you study it outcome benefits in all comers in a large population, you will find substantial differences in safety. Dr. Neuman was not the only one who did these studies. He's a Stavros Methodist who has studied 500,000 patients, 500,000 patients, who received either spinal anesthesia or general anesthesia for lower extremity hip and knee replacement surgery, and found again that spinal anesthesia decreased the critical care services utilization. So again, substantially better. I practiced for years at St. Luke's Roosevelt Hospital Center, a teaching hospital at Columbia University in New York. And this hospital center had 2 institutions. There was a Midtown Hospital, Roosevelt Hospital, and there was an Uptown Hospital, St. Luke's, which was really my family. The St. Luke's Hospital took care of many indigent patients from within Harlem, Bronx, Spanish Harlem. And what was really remarkable about that hospital is we did a lot of very sick patients, such as perhaps this patient over here. This particular patient is on a BiPAP valve, and if you intubated these patients or administered general anesthesia, these patients may never eventually be weaned off of the mechanical ventilation. And yet, a very simple procedure, skillfully performed spinal anesthetic using 2 milliliters of 0.5% isobaric bupivacaine results in an incredibly stable, smooth hemodynamic course, complete anesthetic, and a smooth recovery. And this is what these patients actually look like. Here you can see at the end of the surgery, the hip has been fixed, and these patients continue to do well and do not need intensive care unit admissions or mechanical ventilations. What we do as regional anesthesiologists is truly heroic, but that requires skills, not like in Dr. Neuman's studies, where 15% of patients randomized to spinal had to cross over to general. And if you would like to know how we manage spinal anesthesia for patients with a hip fracture using a protocol in Genk, Zoll, NYSORA, Europe, I cordially invite you to watch this video where we spell it out. The one additional finding in Dr. Neuman's study in the New England Journal of Medicine is the delirium incidence was the same between a spinal and a general anesthesia. That's kind of interesting because if you look at Dr. Neuman's earlier publications, he clearly states that the preoperative administration of benzodiazepines results in adverse outcomes after surgery. That's kind of interesting because according to the design in the New England Journal of Medicine paper, the patients who were randomized to spinal anesthesia were mandated to receive intraoperative sedation. Also, what we don't know is what they received for spinal anesthesia and what medications they were administered for comfort for the administration of the spinal anesthesia. Clearly, the patients who have hip fracture have pain, and in order for them to be positioned for spinal anesthesia, they have to receive a certain analgesic. That is not specified, and it's quite possible that in that study, patients who received spinal anesthesia first received some kind of general anesthesia just for introduction of the spinal. And now we're studying the outcome in delirium. It simply does not make any sense. And just when we thought after release of this video that was viewed by 40,000 people, that the saga was least over or atoned for. Suddenly we have another publication by Dr. Neuman's group, which is in the Annals of Internal Medicine. But in this particular publication, they use the same data set from the same study that they published in the New England Journal of Medicine, but now they dipped into it to look about the pain, analgesic use, and patient satisfaction with spinal versus general anesthesia. And what they concluded in their paper is that spinal anesthesia was associated with more pain at 24 hours after surgery and more prescription analgesic use at 60 days compared to general anesthesia. Now, this is crazy. If you look at their results, you will see that the mean difference in pain was only 0.4 on a VA scale of 0 to 10. 0.4. This is a classical example of a statistically significant and clinically meaningless outcome. Now let's take a look at this paper in anesthesiology that studied pain after shoulder surgery with interscalene block with Exparel versus standard bupivacaine. The paper found that Exparel was statistically better. The difference in VAS score was 1.1. But the paper concluded that clinically it was meaningless. That paper stated that the VAS score of 1.3 had to be met in order to be clinically meaningful. And yet, in the Annals of Internal Medicine, in the paper on the pain and analgesic use in patient satisfaction, the VAS difference was only 0.4. And that was painted as being statistically significant and important to craft the conclusions that spinal anesthesia results in more pain. And if you look at the table with the pain, what you will see is that the only statistically significant result was at 24 hours, where the pain was greater by 0.4, and none of the other data points were actually significant, whether that be statistically or clinically. Although Dr. Neuman and colleagues bought themselves a license to dip into the data one more time, because they pre-planned the secondary analysis, that paper in the Annals of Internal Medicine is a typical textbook example of data dredging. And data dredging is the misuse of data analysis to find patterns in the data that can be presented as statistically significant. And even though they were completely clinically meaningless, data dredging is also referred to as data fishing. You just use a mining practice in which you dip into the large data volume sets and analyze them to find any possible relationship between the data in order to craft a story for your paper. But here we're getting into a discussion of statistical versus clinical relevance. Even though the data point at 24 hours of 0.4 was statistically significant, it was totally clinically irrelevant. And a pain delta of 0.4 is a difference in pain that it's almost impossible for most patients to discern. Moreover, that study in the Annals of Internal Medicine was powered on death at 60 days, not on pain. And if you look at the methodology, you will see that clearly spelled out that we did not do separate power analyses for any secondary outcomes. And therefore, it is a clear definition of the data dredging. Dr. Neuman and colleagues in the Annals of Internal Medicine also state that it's possible that these differences may have been due to the relative undertreatment of pain for patients in the spinal anesthesia group. Of course, that it wasn't the case, because patients with spinal anesthesia are so comfortable after surgery that they may simply have been forgotten in a study setting. And by the time the spinal anesthesia wore off, they started having some pain, which resulted in this clinically meaningless but statistically significant spike of 0.4. One other very surprising finding in that study is that the 73.5, it's a huge percentage of patients after hip fracture surgery in the study had severe pain. This is not something that we see actually very often in our clinical practice. These patients are typically very comfortable because they received the multimodal pain treatment and the fracture has been fixed. Moreover, Dr. Neuman himself in a previous study says that he complained that only 5% of patients with a hip fracture may receive a nerve block for pain. In his studies in the New England Journal of Medicine and Annals of Internal Medicine, nobody received a nerve block for pain management. which is something that is, if you watch our video on treatment of patients with spinal anesthesia and regional anesthesia who are having hip fracture surgery, is a norm, is a standard. Why am I so upset about this? Well, if you read the New England Journal of Medicine Journal Watch, you will see how the pieces that are written on informing the practice unjustly crucify spinal anesthesia as being not safer than general anesthesia. This is something that I'm really very upset about. This was written by Dr. Ganatra, and when I looked up who Dr. Ganatra actually is, it turns out that he is a New England Journal of Medicine Journal Watch editor. He's an internist, which really means that in your practice, you can expect a substantial pushback by internists, surgeons, healthcare workers, patients, and their families who may have read these recommendations informing the practice that spinal anesthesia is no better than general anesthesia, and then you may have more pain. Here's another example why I am concerned about this. This is the Annals of Internal Medicine Summaries for Patients piece. And if you look into this again, this is communicated to the general public. It clearly states that the worst pain was greater with spinal anesthesia, and more patients required pain medications in 60 days. And again, this is based on a study that did not even look into pain and based this power analysis on the death and survival rates rather than on postoperative comfort. Now, to the credits of the authors, they clearly state that it is also important to note that some patients may have medical conditions that make them need to have spinal anesthesia versus general. They clearly say that it's important to note that some patients may have medical conditions that mandates the spinal anesthesia. However, this is not what it shows up in communications to the internists, surgeons, patients, and the general public. The communication that wants to inform the practice clearly states that spinal anesthesia is not safer than general anesthesia for hip fracture surgery, and this is not true. My concern is the widespread dissemination of this data, published in some of the most prestigious journals of medicine, has the potential to mislead our colleagues, internists, surgeons, and perhaps patients and their families in its inference that spinal anesthesia does not make a difference. The consequences may deprive very ill patients of what are sometimes life-saving regional anesthesia techniques. Some of the very co-authors of these articles who have seen my video rebuffing the New England Journal of Medicine article on YouTube have asked me to do another video to atone for unjust conclusions from the Neuman et al. Study in the Annals of Internal Medicine, so here it is. But with these considerations, we must draw attention to the shortcomings of the conclusions of these two published studies. It is vital that we do not allow such potentially harmful conclusions based on flawed premises to permeate our profession unchallenged. So I invite you, colleagues and fellow professionals, to have your say and leave your comment here. And if you like our YouTube channel, make sure you subscribe and never miss the new ones. Until next time.